How's it going, everybody? It's Bro here. Hope you're doing well. And in this video, I'm going to teach you guys all about anonymous innerclasses in Java. So let's get into it. If you find this video helpful, please remember to like, comment, and subscribe. Your support will help keep this channel running. Hey everyone, we're going to be discussing anonymous innerclasses, and I have quite the definition here for you, but don't worry, it won't be too bad. So an anonymous innerclass is an innerclass without a name. Hence the term anonymous, right? So only a single object is created from one when we use this, and this object may have extras or changes, and there's really no need to create a separate innerclass because we only really use this once. And the reason that we use an anonymous innerclass is that it helps us to avoid cluttering code with a separate class name. So the syntax is very similar to using a constructor, except there is also a class definition that comes afterwards within a block of code. And these anonymous interclasses are amazing for action listeners, and you'll see why pretty soon. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to give you guys two examples. One, we'll just make a basic, like, welcome message. And then for the second example, we'll actually use an anonymous interclass for an action listener, and you'll see why these are pretty great. So let's go to our project folder, go to the source folder, and click File, New, Class. And let's call this class maybe Greeting. And we're just going to display a welcome message within this class here. So we'll make a public method that doesn't return anything, so it's void. And we'll call this welcome. All right. And then what we'll do within here is just display a message such as maybe something lame like hello world. Okay, let's create an instance of this greeting class. So normally we would type in greeting, the name of the class, then come up with a name for this unique object. So maybe greeting with a lowercase g equals new greeting. Okay. And then we can use the hello function or the welcome function of our greeting class. So we type in the name of our object greeting dot welcome. And when we run this, it displays hello world. Now we can use an anonymous inner class with this object here, this greeting class. So what we do after the constructor, we're going to add a set of curly braces. And now this is like a whole new class definition. We can actually make a change to one of the methods within here. And I'll actually copy this and paste it within here. And what I'll do is maybe change this message to something professional like, yo bro. And now if we were to run this, this welcome function is actually going to display yo bro, because it's as if we overrid this welcome method within our greeting function. And it's usually good practice to add a message that says override if you override a function of some sort. Now what would happen if we created another instance of the greeting class, but we did not use an anonymous inner class? So we're going to create a greeting to object, and then we're going to use the welcome function of this greeting to object. So we'll add that right after. So greeting to, and we'll use the welcome message and run the program. So greeting one is yo bro, and greeting two is hello world. And that's to be expected because the greeting to instance isn't using this anonymous inner class then. So that's one of the uses for anonymous inner classes, is because you can make some sort of like extras or changes to one specific object. And that's really if you don't feel like creating a separate inner class within another class, if you really only plan on using it once then. So that's the first example. I'm going to give you guys another example of why these are actually great for using action listeners. So I'm actually going to delete all of this, and don't worry, I'll post all of this in the comments down below if you'd like a copy. Then I'll also delete this greeting class. All right, well, for our project, what I think we'll do is create a simple JFrame that contains three buttons, and each of these three buttons will have a action listener that utilizes an anonymous inner class, so they each can do something separate, and you'll see the main benefit of this pretty soon. So let's create a new class. So go to your source folder, then go to File, New Class, and we'll call this maybe MyFrame because I can't think of any better ideas. All right, and we'll want this to extends JFrame. So then go back to your main class, make sure you get this import too. go back to your main class, we're going to create an instance of MyFrame. So MyFrame, and we'll call this instance, maybe MyFrame with a lowercase m, equals new MyFrame. All right, we're going to do everything else within our MyFrame class. So what we'll want to do is create the constructor for the MyFrame class. So we'll add that here, MyFrame, parentheses, curly braces. Let's create three buttons. So we'll instantiate three buttons before our constructor. So to do that, type in JButton, we'll call the first button button1, equals new JButton. And let's add some text right away. So within the parentheses, just type in button number one, I guess. Okay, then we'll need to import something. So javax.swing.jframe. Actually, I'll just import everything here. Okay, so then let's copy these and add a few more buttons. So maybe button two, and change it here as well, and button three. All right, now we'll need to create the frame. So we'll do that within our constructor. So since MyFrame extends the JFrame interface, or parent class, I should say, we'll type in this dot set default close operation JFrame dot exit on close. You probably know the drill by now with JFrames. And this dot set size, probably 500 by 500 for this example. And this dot set layout to null because we don't want a layout manager. Not really necessary. And this dot set visible to true. Okay, let's add all of the buttons to our JFrame. So this dot add button one. Same thing with button two and button three. Okay, we'll also need to set the bounds for each of these buttons. So button one dot set bounds. We'll place this where x is 100, y is 100. This will be 100 by 100 pixels long, so it's a square. Okay, so let's do this for buttons two and three. So button two and button three, and we'll just change the x position to 200 and 300. Okay, let's see what we have so far. Okay, that's not too bad to begin with. Currently, they don't do anything. So with past lessons, if we wanted to utilize an action listener, we would need our JFrame to implement the action listener interface. And I wouldn't copy this down. We're just going to delete this right away. So we would have this class implement the action listener interface. We would need an action performed method. And then we would also need to add the action listener to each of these individual buttons. So for example, we would say button one dot add action listener, and then we need to pass in an action listener, and we can just type in this. So we're passing in an action listener as an argument, but if we use an anonymous inner class, we actually don't have to do all this crap, so we can actually get rid of these, and I'll show you a better way of doing this now. So we're going to get rid of implements action listener, if you did write that down, and instead of passing in this, we're going to create a new action listener. So new action listener, parentheses, and then we're going to create an anonymous inner class within this set of parentheses. So add a set of curly braces, and then you'll probably get a prompt for add unimplemented methods. So this button has its own action performed method now, and we can do something very specific just for button one. And this is kind of like in the first example where we displayed a different print line statement that said, yo bro. So let's type in something different. So system.out.println, maybe you pressed button number one. All right. So let's actually copy all this and paste it and make a few changes for each of these buttons. So button two will have its own action listener, and we're utilizing an anonymous inner class. And this action performed method will do something else, such as you press button two, and let's do the same thing for button three, and you pressed button three. So it's like we don't have to have all these buttons share the same action performed method. They can all have their own, and we don't need this whole class to implement the action listener interface. So this is a lot cleaner coding. So let's try this now. Okay, so here are the three buttons. You press button one, you press button two, you press button three. So we know that it works. So that's one of the great things about using an anonymous inner class. There's no need to create a separate inner class when we're really only going to use this class for one specific thing, like make one specific change. Like for example, an action listener, where we can hook up an action listener to each individual button, and they'll each have their own action performed method. So that's everything you need to know to get started with anonymous inner classes. If you want a copy of all this code, I'll post this in the comments down below. And, well, yeah, that's how anonymous interclasses work in Java. Hey, you. Yeah, I'm talking to you. If you learn something new, then you can help me help you in three easy steps by smashing that like button, drop a comment down below, and subscribe if you'd like to become a fellow bro.